टाइम पे कोई बाहर तो कहीं जा नहीं सकता है, तो हो क्या रहा है कि जिन जिन लोगों से हमें कोचेज हैं प्लेयर्स हैं उन सबसे जिससे पहले बात करने का टाइम कभी कभी नहीं मिलता था बिकॉज दीज गाइज़ वर ऑल बिजी, नाउ वॉट बिजी, एवरीवन इज एट होम सो एवरीवन हैज़ टाइम टू टॉक टू अस, बट टुडे वी गॉट अ वेरी स्पेशल पर्सन जॉइनिंग अस ऑन द शो, हिज नेम इज फ्लॉयड पिंटो एंड इफ यू फॉलो इंडियन फुटबॉल आई एम प्रीटी श्योर यू नो हु ही इज, ही इज बीन क्लोजली एसोसिएटेड विद द इंडिया अंडर 17 टीम विद द इंडियन एरोज, ही इज ऑल्सो बीन हेड कोच ऑफ द इंडिया अंडर 20 साइड. Floyd, firstly, thank you so much for taking your time and joining us. Honest thing being here, that we've been trying to get in touch with Floyd for a while now, but because we had a bit of a pow-pow with the powers that be, this request was kept aside for a while, but the quarantine brings out the best in everyone. So we finally found Floyd. Floyd, thanks. How are you keeping yourself busy nowadays?
Good. It's been a long time coming, like you said. But finally, we get to do this. Thanks to Corona. One of the few things that I can say, thanks to Corona.
Yeah. Watching a lot of videos at home?
A lot. Streaming a lot, reflecting a lot on the past season, thinking what to do next. So I'm using this time very wisely.
Yeah. Since you brought it up, thinking what to do next, you want to share a bit of details? What's the plan? We're still waiting for an ISL coach, an Indian ISL coach. Give us that news.
I have to do my pro license first, so that's also in the pipeline. So hopefully we get it done in India as soon as possible. So I'm hoping to be on that course. But officially or technically speaking, I'm a free agent now. So I'm no longer contracted. So I'm looking for the next project. To be meaningful, I mean, to have a purpose, not just get into any club or any position. Because I want to coach. I don't want to, you know, just be part of the system and do nothing. So I'm biding my time, speaking to a lot of people. And hopefully if I find the right project, and hopefully if it's in Mumbai, because it's been 5 years now, 5 years away from home. And I feel I need to be there. You know, at home because I have an aging mom at home. I've missed home for a long time. So I feel if it's in Mumbai, it's going to be very beneficial for me. So let's see what time has to offer.
In 5 years, you said Floyd has been in the system as such and where you, I suppose, had the opportunity to work on something that didn't have, like, it's not a club in that sense or an academy, no profit motive. You're looking at a wider scene, you're looking at national teams, especially and developing systems and all of that. So it has been, I suppose, the sort of role that you might envision when you get into coaching football. How has that been and how did that sort of come to an end then we'll get into some of the later stuff about your plan.
Prior to joining the AIFF, I was working with Kenkre Football Academy in Mumbai for about 6 years. That was my transition from engineering into football, full time. So the one good thing about working with Kenkre was I got to get my hands dirty in real sense of it. Like I worked with children from the age group of 6 right to the second division I League team. So I managed to build my philosophy or my thought process of how I wanted to see players develop and how I wanted to see a team play. Once that tenure came to the end, I thought, you know, I want to be in a more serious setup, you know, more maybe a residential setup, which would, you know, help me get my message across in a better way. And it would be beneficial to be with the player 24/7. And fortunately, when I did my A license, Scott was on the course. And I spoke to him at length about coaching with the AIFF Academy. And fortunately, a position opened up and I jumped across. And since it was based in Goa, I said, yeah, why not? So coaching in a residential setup was beneficial because, you know, we could work with these boys day in, day out, not just on the field, but also off the field as well. And, and a lot of aspects came to, which added to my repertoire was nutrition. You know, we had to think a lot about the nutrition that we were giving to the players, recovery, sleep patterns, what time of the day to train, and how many times in a day should we train. So all that kind of thing started coming in, which, you know, as a coach, it was challenging for me, and that is what I wanted, because I wanted to add to whatever I had learned in Mumbai. So the residential setup with the AIFF helped me develop further, add these aspects to my coaching philosophy.
Floyd, when you the thing is, you know, because of this corona, COVID-19, there is no live football to talk about. And other than that, we have shown about 4 or 5 of them, they've all been about administration, what is going to happen, outside of the field stuff. So today we thought, when we got someone as celebrated as you and a coach is coming on show, so we're going to talk pure football today, right?
Yeah.
And the point being, when you were associated with the age group teams, more often than not, what's being said is that these age group teams are far ahead from what the seniors were at their age group. So we can expect of a lot of them probably when they move into the senior setup, and hopefully then get better results and a better style of football from the Indian senior side. But as far as the age group team, if I were to say in particular the teams you were coaching, what was the philosophy? Was there a clear philosophy? Because were you always chasing results there, or were you chasing a playing style and the way it should be done?
First of all, when you're working with the age group teams, the first thing that you need to consider is that whatever games we play are with foreign opposition, the best of the best in Asia, and in the South Asian Federation with the SAF. So we had to, whatever we did, we had to win. You know, if you don't win SAF, there was a big repercussion coming in. At the AFC, you had to be competitive and do well. But when I entered the AIFF, it was Scott and Rob Barn who were, putting the AIFF academies in place. And there was a very clear philosophy of playing fluid attacking football and developing players to sustain their physical momentum throughout the 90 minutes. So there was a curriculum in place which Scott had put. So we followed that for the first year when you enter in as a coach. It helped you settle down as far as the philosophy that he wanted to put in place. So once you covered the curriculum for the first year, it was up to you to further enhance it or further develop it. So there was it was a clear philosophy of, you know, we want our players to be comfortable on the ball. Okay. We want our players to not unnecessarily kick the ball ahead. There should be a purpose to it. And if you lose the ball, there should be an organized press in order to win the ball back. So that was a clear philosophy as far as all the age group teams, how they were supposed to play.
But Floyd, of course, that was on paper. And someone who's, of course, worked all the hard yards and done all the hard yards on the ground, how difficult was it to actually put what is on paper and achieve and execute it to a certain level? You can't always execute it 100%, but to a certain level on the field?
It is a challenge at first, because, like I said, I'm coming in from an environment where kids used to come in and go out. The competition level was not that high. And when you come into the AIFF setup, immediately every game that you play, even if it is a practice match with a local team, you are scrutinized to the core. So it's difficult in another sense, because like 5 years I've been in the AIFF, and I have worked with 4 different teams. So be it the under-19 or the under-17, as they graduated, there were 4 different set of players in 5 years. So you get on an average less than a year to work with one age group towards certain competition. So as time passed, you get a hang of how to get your message across to the players. And a very important aspect of that was identifying the right player. If we identified the right player, we knew that within this span of time, before the competition gets in, we will get our message across to this kind of player, and he will develop to our liking, do the way we want to play. So identification was a very clear priority for us. And fortunately, me and Bibiano, we were based in Goa. He was with the under 16s and I was with the under 19s. We used to constantly keep in touch with each other and discuss as to, you know, what are you looking for in a player? Because we had to match our thinking in certain ways, because a player that would play under him eventually in a year and a half, 2 years time would come under me.
Yeah.
So there was a lot of planning that went across in the background to make sure that we don't overcomplicate things, and we try to make it as simple as possible for these players to pick the philosophy up and then utilize it on the ground. And it depends on player to player. My very first team that I picked up was the age group of Anirudh Thapa and Jerry Lalganswala, that age group. And to be honest, they were in the AIFF system for at least 2 to 3 years prior to me taking over. And they had got a lot of exposure playing against foreign opposition. They had won the under 16 SAF tournament as well. So there was so much of information that they had gained. It was very easy for me to work with those players, because it was like literally like playing PlayStation with them. No? Like, I'm a very tactical oriented coach. I work a lot on tactics. I like to find ways in which I can go one up on the opposition tactically. And that group of players had the technical requirements, they had the mentality, and they had the tactical understanding of what I wanted to do at that point of time. So it was a very smooth transition for me taking over that age group team. But another disadvantage as far as the AFC calendar is concerned, now Anirudh Thapa's group won the AFC under 16, won the SAF under 16, and they played the AFC under 16 qualifiers. But then they were ineligible to play the under 19s because of the age group.
Okay.
Because, example, there's a 2 year age difference between the under 16s and under 19 AFC and SAF. So if you play the under 16s, for example, either you are a year overage for the under 19s or you are a year underage. So for example, if Thapa is 98 born, okay, and he the next cutoff for the under 19s was 99 born. So that entire group of Thapa was rendered not eligible for AFC competition, so they had to move on to clubs.
So then Floyd, and, would you say, because we always discuss this, man, that, you know, while at the 16 age group, we're doing really well, right?
Yeah.
And we're playing well against good teams. But suddenly we move to 19 and, you know, suddenly that consistency in results does not add up. Would you say this is one of the big reasons for that? That the batch move along together?
It's not only moving along together. It's that the development of a player from under 16 to under 19 abroad is much higher than what it's happening in India. Basically, the players that are playing abroad are training and playing much more matches, competitive matches, training with maybe their first teams or their under 19s respectively, and playing a lot of tournaments and gaining a lot of experience physically, technically and tactically. That is the difference between us, because I have noticed with our players, not only in the AIFF but also in Kenkre Academy, whenever we used to go abroad to play a particular tournament, we improved gradually as the tournament went on. As the players got accustomed with the opposition that they are playing, they automatically picked it up so fast that by the time we reached the maybe the penultimate or the last game, which was maybe too late in some competitive competitions, we could match these players and do better. So the more these boys get exposure to these kind of tournaments, teams, and they play at that level, or what is happening right now is that the boys are training with their respective first teams, maybe in the ISF. For example, those players coming in to the AIFF setup for the respective SAF and AFC tournaments are at a much better position to understand and pick up philosophy faster and implement it on the ground than someone who's training locally without a proper team structure behind him.
It's interesting you say that. I mean, we had Richard Hood on the last show. That we did of Bangalore United head coach. So Richard was saying exactly the same thing about his team, that even within a tournament, as the tournament progressed, you know, the team got better, everything started to work out better, and the quality of football and how they were playing, everything just went up. So yeah, I wanted to ask you, we were talking, since you were talking about how closely you and Bibiano worked with the under-16s and the under-19s, there was still a very different style of play between both those teams, right? At the end, in competitive matches, especially ones which had important qualifying sort of ends to it. So how does this sort of, suppose building on what Pandit was asking, when people talk about, when people talk about a philosophy or an Indian way of playing football, and you guys are teaching that to kids across various age groups and hoping that it translates into something for the senior national teams at the end, how does that actually pan out? Because you're under 16, mein aap, let's say regional level pe, you're a boss, you're dominating. Or even at the Asian level, you're trying to play more attacking football because A, the kids are younger and therefore that's just how younger kids like to play and so on and so forth. As you get older, the consequences matter more, whatever the reasons might be. How easy is it for us to sit and say we should have an Indian way of playing football? And how does it actually
work? As far as the AIFF boys are concerned, if you have a look at the current national team or the ISL first teams that are there right now, there are majority of the players who have come through the system. From my knowledge is concerned, from the first team that I picked up was Thapa's age group. And from that age group till Amarjit recently and Jackson Singh, that age group, Suresh, etc. They are all not just bench warmers. They are in the first teams of ISL teams competing. And it is not just about a particular style of play. At this point of time, I feel it is more important to develop players who can adjust to different styles of play better. Because what used to happen is, and it happened with me as well, I had a particular way of playing and I was trying to get the message across to the players to play that certain way. But what I found would be more handy is, yes, I know what I want. And I've seen this happen in Europe as well, is that you create an environment of how you want these boys to play. And the players that pick things up quickly, you will see them on the ground in training sessions during matches. And those are the players that you need to work on. Because no matter how hard you try to get the message across to the player, if he's not going to pick things up, he's not going to be helpful to you in the long run. So players like Amarjit, players like Anirudh Thapa, players like Jackson, Suresh, they are like a sponge, you know, they absorb information so quickly. And I mentioned this about why I was so happy with that I-League season of ours, not because we finished eighth or not because we had 21 points. It's because from the start of the season to the end of the season, these boys were so much more different. They were known as a physically super fit counter-attacking side, which they had learned a lot through preparing for the World Cup and then playing the World Cup. But as the I-League season progressed, we started building up from the back. We started keeping the ball possession more. We had more ball possession than the opposition, but then we couldn't convert chances. Then we started having more ball possession, converting chances. And there were games like the Mohun Bagan game, the last game of the season, where we had to just dig deep and just hold on and just counter, which I knew these guys could do with their eyes closed. And it happened. The very next game in the Super Cup, we outplayed Kerala Blasters. We had more ball possession. We had more chances on target. So adding that versatility to your game is not for every player. And you see the players that are coming up and breaking into first teams of the ISL and the I-League are the ones who are adaptable, who can perceive what the coach wants, adapt to the situations, adapt to the training sessions, and then start to produce results for the team. That is what I feel we are coming to now, because it's not about developing a style of play, it is about developing players who can be more versatile.
Floyd, since you brought up these boys, and rightly so, they're doing pretty well for their clubs amongst the big boys of Indian football. One player that's been a massive favourite for me and Siddhant since the Under-17 World Cup is where we saw him, and the build-up to the Under-17 World Cup is Boris. And because that boy's trajectory hasn't really gone in the same way as, say, an Amarjit or a Thapa and a Jackson. And I mean not by a big team signing you up for big money, but I mean by getting playing time. Could you shed some more light on that boy? What is the scene?
I just think he needs to find a team that is going to give him game time. That's the only thing stopping these guys from playing. And a great example to give you is Nongdamba. You know, yeah. he couldn't find a first team place in the I-League squad that we were in when we were in the I-League under Matos and under me as well. And he left and joined Kerala Blasters. Mm-hmm. And he didn't play for Kerala Blasters. He left, he realized that he is not going to get chance, and he left on loan and joined Mohun Bagan. And now you see where he is right now. Mm-hmm. So it's with every player that that is there. Boris, in fact, Komal is alongside him.
Yeah.
In ATK as well. It's just a matter of them finding a team that gives them the opportunity to play. Sometimes it may not be an ISL team, it may be an I-League team, or even it may be a second division I-League team. But that's their decision. It's not the fault of the coach. It's not the fault of the club. I would say it is the decision of the player and his agent to find the right team where he can get a chance to play.
It's basically a decision between the riches of money that you've been working for all these years, and suddenly that big payday comes, and then choosing, do I want to continue playing or do I want to take that big payday? But it's a tough decision, right, Floyd, for a player?
It's a very tough decision, especially with that age group team, which is the World Cup team, that has seen highs like no other AIFF Academy player has seen before. They have been to every corner of the world. They have stayed in the best of hotels. They've had the best food. They had the best training. They played the World Cup. So for them, it's the most difficult decision ever to say, okay, I don't want this lucrative contract. I want game time. But it's about a year or two. I think that period is there now. Maybe once Boris has seen, okay, what's happened to him at ATK for 1 year, it's going to be interesting to see what he does this coming season. And maybe he takes the example of a Nong and tries to get his career back on track.
Sorry, Annie, just one more question on this. Floyd, since you've been so closely associated with these boys, you suppose they're getting the right advice from the outside, and they're surrounding themselves with the right people who are advising them and helping them make the right career moves?
At this point of time, I think these players are smart enough. They're really street smart. So it will be foolish to say that they are not getting advice. Like I said, at the end, it's the onus on the player to make the final decision. You are responsible for the decisions that you make. You can fault a player who's maybe never played before and suddenly comes into the limelight and maybe makes a mistake. But these boys have seen everything ahead of them. They've maybe spoken to more agents than you and me ever know exist, not only in India, but abroad as well. So they know what's happening abroad. They know what's happening in India. They know what's happening in each and every club that's running out here. So for them to take a decision, I think it comes after a long debate with their close ones. So I don't think it's the advice that they're getting, it's the decision that they are making which will reap benefits for them, or maybe stall their career for maybe a year or two.
Floyd, in this final part of the show, because yahan pe hamare jo dost hai na, Siddhant ne kaha ki this conversation will go on for 24 hours non-stop, because we just need a press play button to talk football. But कहीं ना कहीं चले जाते हैं हम, सोशलिज्म पे चले जाते हैं हम, सोशल मीडिया पे चले जाते हैं. बट पॉइंट इज, इन पर्टिकुलर इफ यू कुड टॉक अबाउट अ कपल ऑफ गेम्स, बिकॉज यू मेंशन एट द स्टार्ट ऑफ द शो दैट यू लव टैक्टिक्स, यू लव टैक्टिकली रीडिंग अ टीम एंड प्रिपेयरिंग फॉर अ टीम एंड प्रिपेयरिंग योर टीम इन द प्रोसेस. टू गेम्स दैट गिव यू अ लॉट ऑफ सेटिस्फैक्शन एज अ कोच, सेइंग दैट दिस वर्कड एंड प्रोबेबली दैट कुड बी अ ब्लूप्रिंट, मे बी नॉट अ सेट ब्लूप्रिंट, बट वन ऑफ द ब्लूप्रिंट्स गोइंग फॉरवर्ड इन इंटरनेशनल फुटबॉल.
The first game was the COTIF match against Argentina. Why I would like to talk about that game is, like I said before, when our players went abroad to play against foreign opposition, as the tournament grew on them, they got better and better. And they adapted to the situation. And at the end, you know, they were very competitive with against the teams that they played. So there were four matches that we played in quarter. We lost the first two games. But the philosophy at that time for that squad, which had just played the Under-17 World Cup and the I-League prior to that, we were primarily a very defensive and a counter-attacking team at that point of time. And this tournament was the first tournament that I took over as the head coach. And it was almost like a preseason for us. We just had 10 days of training prior to this tournament. So we couldn't change much as far as the philosophy is concerned, but we could make minor tweaks to the philosophy so that we can smoothen the transition when we went into the I-League. So we knew that in this tournament, we will have to be as defensively a solid unit as possible. And as we went on through the tournament, the draw against Venezuela gave us a lot of confidence. Okay, we can defend. And we created a few chances which we couldn't convert. So, but what we changed during that period of time, during that period of training, was not just defending passively. It was, at certain point of time, there were cues. And the two most aggressive players in our team were Amarjit and Suresh. They were the one who triggered triggered the pressing aspect for our team, because they had energy to run for maybe 120 minutes in any given weather and condition. So we said, okay, you know, Argentina were playing a 4-4-2 system. So we said, you know, whenever their midfielders get the ball, don't allow them to distribute the ball as freely as they were in previous games. And obviously, when the ball went on the wings, we had our wingers in Nintoy and Rahul pressing. So that was a small change tactically, where yes, we were defending deep, but we were not defending passively. We were constantly pressing them as soon as they entered into our half, and it frustrated Argentina to a certain extent that a team of that quality, a team of that caliber, were making a lot of mistakes in their diagonal balls, in their first touch. And fortunately, we got a goal out of a set piece where Deepak Tangri went towards the first post, tried to get a header on the ball, but he missed it. But the goalkeeper fumbled it and the ball went in. So we got that buffer in our pocket that, you know, okay, we have a one goal lead. But that small change in our pressing aspect, not waiting for the opposition to make the pass, forcing them to make a pass that we knew that they're going to make, was a small tactical change that I could do during that period of time. And Mahesh was very much involved in that process, because defensively, he's the king. So he instructed the players as far as one versus one defending, body shape is concerned, moving as a unit. So when the first defender pressed, where the others had to go to cover the space. So we worked a lot on those small aspects, that when we were defending deep, how to press the opposition at the right point of time and how to react to certain situations as far as diagonal balls are concerned, etc. Then we had another, what impressed me a lot about this batch, Aniket Jadhav got sent off in the second half. Just as the second half began, he got a red card. Even then, Suresh and Amarjit didn't make us feel that we were one man down. They were pressing with the same aggression and the same intensity that they were when Aniket was on the pitch. So that was so good to watch. And then Anwal Ali scored probably the goal of the tournament at that point of time. And so, you know, that was a small step in the direction that I wanted to take this team forward. As to, yes, you know, you are a very good, super fit side, defending deep, good on the counter-attack. But that transition from defending passively to defending actively was the thing that we achieved from that tournament. A small thing that we picked up, which we knew could help us in the I-League.
You know, Floyd, it's funny you say that because I feel like you've given Arjun Pandit, the tactician, some validation. And why you've done that is because right now during this Vela period, I thought, chalo, we guys will analyze some of India's World Cup and Asian Cup qualifiers. So I was going through the first game versus Oman that was played at Guwahati. And the same thing I saw, and this is an Indian mentality, I don't know why, and maybe you could stress, you could sort of dwell on it. As soon as we scored the opening goal there, Chhetri scored the opening goal, before that, we were on top of Oman. We were tackling them, we were not giving them time on the ball, and we were holding play and making attack. Jaisi goal mara, 8-8, 9-9 peeche aage. And they were there for a major remainder of the rest of the game, right? Upar se what I saw, 4 midfielders, 4 defenders, and Oman had 4 players attacking with, and the 4 attackers had all gone and stuck with the 4 defenders. And the 4 midfielders was just not doing anything because there's no one to mark. So what you're talking about, that passively thing. Na?
Yeah.
So while we had that man advantage, we had clearly like eight guys to their 5 guys. But since they were moving around and no one was really going at them, they were easily moving the ball, finding the gaps. And then as a result, you know, they took advantage on that. Is this a problem you've seen in Indian teams? You score and then suddenly you go back.
It's a problem with the mentality because, you know, a lot of things happened during the 90 minutes. Like I said, you know, when we lost Aniket, had Amarjit and Suresh gone into their shell, the entire pressing process what we had worked on would have gone haywire. The entire thing would have gone haywire. It is the players that make the philosophy or the system work. And funny you say that about the national team because I've had a few conversations with Igor as well. You know, he's so calm, so cool, and he knows exactly what he wants out of this Indian national team. But the problem is it's going to take some time.
Yeah.
Because at this point of time, I think he has identified the players that he wants to play. And this is exactly what I'm talking about. He's not keen on playing passively. He wants to play actively, both when we have the ball and when he doesn't have the ball. But for him to get that message across is so difficult because he's not constantly 24/7 with the players throughout the season. Yeah. So he has to rely on these camps at every camp to give them certain amount of information. And then, like I said, create that system where the player themselves are picking up information for you. And he's created such a system right now that if you want to play there, you need to be able to do these kind of things. No matter how good you are or no matter whether your team has won the ISL or the I-League, it doesn't matter. You need to do this in this position. And if you're able to do that, sustain the intensity of the game that he requires, then he'll give you every chance to play for the national team. So it's interesting to see, and I'm quite closely following the transition of the national team with every camp and with every game that they play.
On a lighter note, AIFF, if you're looking for a coach for your AIFF Dwarka 11, officials 11, I'm right here and I'll come pretty cheap as well. Just give me one banana and one glass of milk and I'll be there. any other game, Floyd, you want to talk about? You spoke about Argentina right now. Any other game that gave you satisfaction, man? And you know, you had a good night's sleep after that.
See, if you say satisfaction, then it has to be the Super Cup game against Kerala Blasters. Because everything that we did, I cannot say that it is the tactics during that game only. It was the entire I-League season which helped us get in all the information that we required from them as far as building up from the back, as far as we wanted to encourage more 1v1s because we had players like Nintoy, Rahul KP, Sandeep Stalin, who were so good, so quick that as soon as they got the ball and started dribbling at defenders, they were shit scared. You know, their legs started trembling because these guys were so fast and so quick. And then we had Amarjit and Suresh, who could break through midfield and get in that extra man into the box. And Amarjit was the one who got 2 goals in that game. Through his sheer work ethic, through his sheer timing of his runs into the box, and he's on penalties for us, so he got the second goal. So what impressed me about that game was that whatever we'd worked through the entire season, you know, there are some games you don't need to motivate the boys, you know, just by saying, yes, we are playing Kerala Blasters in the Super Cup. That's it, it's done. So these boys are automatically switched on. So it was just a matter of getting the finer details as far as set pieces are concerned, as to what Kerala Blasters were doing. And in one of those set pieces, Deepak Sangri got a clear header and we got a penalty out of it. So there were a lot of things, small aspects. But throughout the I-League season, we worked on our build-ups, we worked on possession, we worked on penetrative passes, we worked on 1v1s. Nintoy beat the left-back 1v1, crossed, Amarjit scored with his first touch. So all these kind of movements that we saw were done during the entire season. It was not that it's come out of the blue. So we practiced it throughout the entire season. As a coaching staff, we watched a lot of videos, analyzed and made the players go through these kind of movements. And eventually it paid off and we got that win against Kerala Blasters. So it was very satisfying for me because I knew that was the last game with this age group, with these boys are concerned. And to see these boys develop from that Kotiv game where we were just defending deep and counter-attacking to this Kerala Blasters game, where they were actually dominating possession and creating chances. And it was an open game of football and such a joy to watch, you know, that kind of a game. The confidence that these boys have to adapt to different kinds of situations, like in Argentina and this kind of situation. So that was satisfying for me as a coach, for Mahesh, as a coaching staff, that we were able to get this message across to the boys. And now we were confident that these boys are ready for the footballing world out there, wherever they end up playing, that, you know, these guys will adapt to wherever they go and set the standard.
And Floyd, as you're rounding up your top three, you'd mentioned the AIFF Shield game. So
yeah, that was the game against the Crystal Palace under 18 side. So there were two foreign teams that were invited to play the AIFF Shield. So one was the Crystal Palace under 18 team and one was the Friends United team from Malaysia. And we had beaten them 4-1 in the group stage. But it is very easy, like you said, you know, implementing your philosophy against teams like these in a pressure environment. And funny enough, you know, just before that game, I had a conversation with Scott and it was on email. It was like, you know, I think the suggestion was that your team is too open. It plays too open. And if you're going to do that against a team like Crystal Palace, you know, you may concede a lot of goals. I was never a one who's going to shy away from an opinion, because and Scott was someone who was very open. Thanks to him that I was able to implement whatever I was able to do with the AIFF. So I wrote him back a long reply as to why I wanted to make these boys play the way they are playing. You know, because it was natural to the boy, to these boys like Anirudh, Jerry, Amit Tudu, Prasanjit, Bodo, all these boys. It was natural for these boys to play that kind of football. Because anything other than that would take away the talent that they had and would not showcase them the way they did. And we had played like that throughout the tournament. And Crystal Palace had scored a lot of goals against a lot of teams. But then again, you know, those were all club teams. It was not the AIFF Academy team. And it was such an entertaining match. It ended, we were leading 2-0. We were leading 2-0 and it ended 2-2 and we won on penalties. We were leading 2-0 at halftime. And even then, it was like, you know, let's shut shop and keep the two-goal lead. And there was a constant disagreement between certain players and even the staff. But then I asked Thapa, what do you want to do? He said, sir, we play the way we want to play. And we started the tournament playing the 4-3-3 system. But we ended up playing against Crystal Palace a 3-4-1-2 system, which was working for us. So the debate at halftime was, should we go back to that 4-3-3 or should
4-3-3,
we...
4-3-3, yeah.
Or should we play with a 3-4-2-1, which had got us the two goals. But Anirudh knew and even I knew there was a lot of indecisiveness in the squad. And once that starts creeping in, that, you know, we have to keep that two-goal lead, that was our undoing. That was our undoing, and that got in Crystal Palace, and what they within 5 minutes in the second half, our back four, who was playing high line very successfully, because we knew if we want to press them, we need to have the line high up, and we need to be as in line as possible. They were in doubt and they dropped, and as they dropped, it created that big gap between the back four and our mid, the back three and the midfielders. And what happened was, since it was a back three, there was a lot of space on the wings. So as soon as they dropped, there was a player receiving the ball in that space, half space, and penetrating with through passes with their wingers running in.
Yeah.
And they were creating chance after chance after chance. And I think in the 8th minute of the second half, we conceded a goal, the first goal. But even then, we kept going. We recovered a little bit. And it was in the 91st or the 2nd minute where we conceded a penalty. And it was 2-2. And you know, this was the actual Crystal Palace under-18 side. It was not like a community development side or something like that. And they were strong, they were physical, and they were technically so good on the ball. So we had to play the way we did to nullify their strong points. Imagine them not having the ball. If they don't have the ball, they're not going to be able to do the things that they do when they have the ball. So that was our plan. And it went well till halftime. We conceded that goal. We recovered a little bit. We couldn't score, but we conceded a penalty. But then, fortunately, in the penalty shootout, we didn't miss a single penalty. Prabhsukan Gill was in goal, and he saved a penalty, and we went into the finals. That and after that, again, it was a big conversation with Scott as to going forward. This is why I want this team to play the way it is. You know, we may look in disarray, maybe. You know, we may look like we are in disarray, but trust me, these boys know exactly what they are doing. And I might not have done that with my current under-19 team. I may not have done that because it depends on the players that you have.
Yeah.
But that age group, that group of Papa Jerry, Prasenjit, was so good on the ball, and they were so in tune with each other because they've played with each other for so many years. They were not part of any club side. They were just in the AIFF Academy training together prior to in Kalyani and then in Goa. So they knew each other like the back of their hand. And it was poetry in motion, basically. So we had to play the way we played against Crystal Palace. And that for me as a coach in my first year in AIFF, that was a defining point for me as well. Okay, this gives you confidence as a coach that, you know, you can play against a team like Crystal Palace and win. Because prior to that, I had no experience of playing a foreign side with the AIFF Academy. We had no exposure prior to that. The only thing we had was the IFA Shield, where we played against Friends United and we played against Crystal Palace. So that was a game to look forward to.
Pretty comprehensive. Yeah, it felt so good. It felt so good to talk football. Yeah, you know, I was tired of this COVID, this COVID, that, and here, this, here, that. So after a long time, yeah. Floyd, firstly, thank you so much for your time. Yeah, taking your time and talking to us. But हमारे साथ ये होता है ना कि हम वो हैं कि एक बारी आपने थोड़ा हाथ दिखा दिया फिर हम पूरा पूरा हाथ ले लेते हैं अंदर. ये नहीं किसी उंगली से हम खुश रहते हैं. So we'll of course get back with you.
Yeah. For football, anytime. Yeah. दोनों हाथ दे देता हूँ ले लो.
No, so we'll get back to you 100%. Yeah. With the promise that we can do a lot more chats on the game, on philosophy, and not really system and administrative stuff, because there are so many people to handle that side of things and can talk about it. But so it was a lovely chat, Floyd. I hope you enjoyed this chat with us.
Yeah, it was very refreshing to talk only football. And in fact, you could get more into detail, but in times.
Floyd, once again, thank you so much for your time. And as always, we will try calling you back now that you've become a friend of the show. Whether you will say it or not, हम बोल देते हैं. हमें क्या है? हम तो बोल देंगे. उसके बलबूते पे हम बुलाते रहते हैं लोगों को. रणदीप सिंह, रिचर्ड होड, अशफाक अहमद. We'll try to get Gauramangi. And also, we're going to try getting Mahesh bhai also on the show. So possibly a day when probably you and Mahesh could be on the show with us. And at least you could control the fanboying that me and Siddhant will be doing. And you could add some balance to the show.
I'm as a big fan as you are of Mahesh. So you know, and I've worked with him, so now that I've grown even more a bigger fan of him, having worked with him on a daily basis. So it's a pleasure being on the show anytime and anytime anywhere for football, to talk about it and to express my views and listen, especially to people who have anything to say about football. Because whenever you have a podcast like this, I'm always in tune to it. Be it with the technical director, you had a pretty long and a pretty intense talk with him.
The cameraman passed out in that show. They passed out. They've never heard of football, let alone Indian football. They're the Indian cricket types. So after 35 minutes, they said, "Yahan gaadi band nahi hone wali. Chale jao yahan se, nikal jao."
Imagine if the camera passed out. Imagine what people in India must be doing when it comes to youth development. Now you know how difficult it is. It requires a lot of patience, and I hope that we can have that in the coming years.
Thank you so much, Floyd. We're going to put out our new headline, Floyd Pinto praises 420 grams, and we'll only play this 30-second clip. And that'll be the show. Thank you once again, and thank you for your time.
Yeah. Thanks a lot, man. Thank you.
Take care, Floyd. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.